Is there life outside Earth? Is a question we may answer within our lifetime, though we should remain skeptical about any claims surrounding extraterrestrial life. For the first time in the history of our species, we may have the means to find out whether we are alone in the universe. Neil deGrasse Tyson is an American astrophysicist, author, and among one of the most popular science communicators. He explains that the universe is vast, with hundreds of billions of exoplanets, and so life on Earth is most likely not unique.
So look at beavers. Right, beavers are mammals. They have large brain, like relative to other branches on the tree of life, and they fully exploit the resources in their environment. Oh, there's a tree. I'm going to use that tree to dam this river, and I'm going to make an underground den. Are we any different from that? We use trees. Well, first we use grass to make huts. That was available. Then we use trees. That's pretty convenient. Then we found metal. Oh my gosh, let's use that, okay? And then we learned how to make alloys. Let's do that. And then we learned chemistry. Let's do that. So yes, it takes thresholds of intelligence to exploit your environment even more, but the simple act of exploiting an environment is not unique to being human. The Romans were no less smart than anyone who followed them, all right? Smart in terms of what their brain could figure out, but they didn't have alien communication technologies. They didn't have radio telescopes. They didn't go into space. So imagine the Roman Empire and aliens are waiting for a return signal back through space. And no return signals.
Since the beginning of civilization, people have wondered whether there is life elsewhere in the universe. Today, the world's most powerful telescope will offer new tools to address this question. With this gigantic mirror and ultra-sensitive detectors, the James Webb Space Telescope will examine countless distant unexplored worlds orbiting distant stars. There could be important signs of life in the composition of the atmospheres of the exoplanets. When an exoplanet passes across the face of its star, sunlight passes through its atmosphere and could be picked up by the JWST. Of course, the most interesting kind of alien life we would hope to find signs of is technological life, which could be identified by looking for the presence of chemicals that don't occur naturally. But maybe we are biased towards the trait of intelligence and overestimate its importance in the possible vast sea of life throughout the cosmos. After all, intelligent life as we define it on our planet has been dominant only for a small fraction in the history of life on Earth.
And here we were, some kind of fist size or smaller shrew or some kind of rodent running underfoot, trying to avoid becoming hors d'oeuvres for T-Rex, and that's how it would have stayed if the dinosaurs didn't just get unlucky and an asteroid takes them out, pries open the niche, an ecological niche that allows mammals to evolve into something more ambitious than a rodent. Meanwhile, rodents are still among us. So I want to impress upon people, if they didn't otherwise sort of wrap their head around it, that we went from rodents to humans in 65 million years, and that's a vanishingly small fraction of a billion years, and Earth has been around for 4 billion years. Now, here's the tricky part. If you line up, this is a little thought experiment, if you just lay Earth's timeline out on the wall, left to right, beginning to end, and then you walk up to it, you don't know where you are, and you pin the tail. Most of the places on that timeline you pin it, Earth only had single-celled life. Complex life was relatively late, last half a billion years. And then what we call intelligent life and big brain mammals, even smaller than that. The point is, if Earth is any indication, if it ever gets to that, then it's fast. Or the other side, flip side of that is, imagine the asteroid never came. There'd still be dinosaurs here today. You know how I know that? Because dinosaurs were around as a community for 300 million years before the asteroid. So what this tells us is what we think of as intelligence clearly is not important for survival. Otherwise, roaches would have really big brains. Right? So maybe the big mistake here is thinking that intelligence is an inevitable consequence of evolution, when all it would have taken was one broken branch. But then that could have taken out all the mammals from the vertebrate chain, and then we would not have anything like we think of today as intelligent creatures. That's how you get to win the argument in the end. You say, oh, what are the chances of that happening? One in a million? okay, one in a million, and there's 100 billion star systems. So run the numbers. No one is thinking we're alone out there.
English science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke once said, two possibilities exist. Either we are alone in the universe or we are not. Both are equally terrifying. We know that our own galaxy, the Milky Way, contains about 100 billion stars, and there are more than 2 trillion galaxies in the observable universe. So the math strongly suggests life must be ubiquitous throughout the cosmos. However, we still have yet to obtain evidence to infer the existence of alien life. As we've discussed many times in our videos before, this problem is known as the Fermi Paradox. In the 1961, U.S. astronomer Frank Drake, in an attempt to estimate the likelihood of discovering intelligent extraterrestrial life in the galaxy, formulated the now famous Drake equation. But it still remains speculative. So how can we find signs of alien life?
I think the only sensible way to do it is to just, we have a sample of one, so let's just start with that and ask, what fraction of the total timeline of Earth has Earth had what we would call intelligent life, big-brained life? And what fraction of that period has it had intelligent, the Drake equation, and what fraction of that period has intelligent life with technology? So if you do that, then that gives you a set of fractions that you can layer onto the entire stellar population of the galaxy. And even using highly conservative estimates, you do not come out with us being the only life form around. If you look at the actual map of the galaxy where we have found these 4,000 exoplanets, it's this tiny little circle around. The star has to be close enough to get good data to know whether it has another planet around it. And you say to yourself, gosh, this is what leads to that analogy that comes from the SETI Institute, where they say, if you're going to say, well, how have we found life? We haven't found life yet. And that's like taking a cup, an empty glass, and scooping it into the ocean and pulling it out and saying, the ocean has no whales from this tiny sample of the vast ocean that you know you have yet to search.
With the development of space telescopes such as Webb, we still have hope we will find signs of extraterrestrial life, maybe somewhere out there in the vast space of the cosmos. An intelligent species is wondering whether they are alone in the universe and are pointing their instruments and looking towards us.
If you're on the moon, how well can you see sort of cities on Earth? Not very well. But if you're going to go 250,000 miles away from them and stand on the moon, you become much less visible. And that's our nearest neighbor in space. Space is vast. So to directly image a planet, yes, that could be on our horizon. But to image it in a way where we're going to see roads and cities, I think that's unrealistic. But I say that. But smiling because I know what we're already up to, right? You want to see life forms waving back at you. What I want to see is any evidence in the atmosphere that anybody's alive on that planet's surface. These are, we call them collectively biomarkers. So we only have oxygen because we have life. That's the only reason. And not only because we have life, the life is constantly making oxygen. Because oxygen chemically is highly reactive. So if you start out with a planet that's born with oxygen, it'll go away. It is going to react with all manner of things and it'll go to zero in very little time. So the fact that we have an active fraction, 20-21% air of oxygen, tells you something is constantly making it, and that's the photosynthesis in plant life. So if you find a planet that has a stable supply of oxygen, oh my gosh, bump that to the top of the list. And there are other unstable molecules like methane, although there are other ways you can make methane. But the people who are in the business of studying the chemistry of atmospheres, they've got a laundry list of molecules that will be the product of all kinds of life that we know goes on here on Earth. So we have this cottage industry of people studying the atmospheres of exoplanets. Now that we have the catalogs of exoplanets ready for our perusal. And I think that's where the answers are going to come.
Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by liking, subscribing, and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.